But I was struck by his dauntlessness and unswerving determination. He addressed the small gatherings in his characteristic confidence and chatted with us in the same spirit. 3 years later, when I met him during the historic Lahore session of the All India Muslim League in 1940, his grand mission to convert the league into a mass organization had materialized to a large extent. This was due mainly to his singularly gifted and dynamic leadership and untiring endeavors of the ever-increasing league workers. Muslims in their large numbers were thronging the league platform everywhere. The momentous Pakistan resolution that we adopted in that session under Mr. Jinnah's leadership was an epitome of this new realization and awakening. Muslim India had discovered its long sought for goal and was poised for its voyage towards it. It was a turning point in our history, a most glorious moment for the Muslim millions. Mr. Jinnah was happy, but not ebullient. He was confident yet grim, as he always used to be. In his speech, he appealed to our minds, but did not pander to our sentiments. He was very much the same old stuff, and his subsequent public speeches revealed that the same remained his watchword: unity, faith, and discipline. What an austere disciplinarian was the man in Mr. Jinnah can be appreciated from the following incident. It was the year 1946. General elections were knocking at the door of India. Mr. M.A. Jinnah, by now the Qaid Azam of the Indian Muslims, undertook an electioneering campaign through Bengal and Assam. He and his entourage started from Calcutta in a train, Christian Pakistan special. Even at wayside and flag stations, the train was forcibly stopped by crowds lustily waiting for long hours and sometimes days to have a glimpse of their beloved leader. The Qaid was desperately trying to resist such unscheduled stoppages, but he was often helpless as the frenzied crowds were found to have blocked the railway line, with people lying on the railway track and trees or even elephants placed on it. The Mymensingh railway station, like most others on his route, was buzzing for days with his followers from far and wide. When the Pakistan special arrived there at midnight, it was late by about 30 hours. The long waiting crowd started running to and fro in their anxiety to see the leader. Some mounted the house roofs, some others started climbing the nearby trees, while a group of people ran to the railway overbridge. In this melee, the Qaid was requested to alight from the train and address the crowd from upon the overbridge. But the indisciplined conduct of the crowd annoyed him so much that he firmly refused to oblige them in spite of their sky-rending slogans till daybreak. One can understand the risk he braved for his strong sense of discipline. An average politician would never have dared refuse audience to such a big crowd on the eve of the crucial 1946 elections, which was to decide the fate of his long-cherished dream, Pakistan. Incidentally, a few stations ahead in my own constituency, I was waiting with another crowd of the Qaid's admirers. Before the Pakistan special could reach there, I was already alerted about what happened at Mymensingh. Accordingly, I kept my people exhorting to demonstrate perfect discipline when the Qaid should arrive. The train arrived. The people remained standing like a battalion of trained soldiers, intermittently chanting the slogans of Pakistan Zindabad, Muslim League Zindabad, Qaid Azam Zindabad, and so on. The Qaid came out of the train with a beaming face and spoke a few words to them. He remarked, the people in this rural area were much more disciplined than those he saw at the Mymensingh town. Little did I let him know that the Mymensingh incident had served as a warning to make these rural people behave. This is how he used to impart discipline among the utterly disorganized Muslim nation, and this was, in my opinion, his secret of success in forging unity among them. Even a man of the stature of Sher-e-Bangla A.K. Fazlul Haq was not spared when he violated the discipline of the Muslim League. A humble lieutenant of that great leader, I had the honor to be with him on numerous occasions and in various places like Calcutta, Madras, Karachi, Allahabad, Delhi and so on. Our meeting after independence became a routine affair. There was something inexplicable in that frail, cold and seemingly proud man which kept us almost hypnotized around him. The magnetism of his personality, his power of wordy duel, which was tremendous, indeed his parliamentary debate at the conversation table or on the public platform, he was always a devastating contender, a terror to his adversaries and a cynosure of all eyes. His deep appreciation of the golden principles of unity, faith and discipline are also considered as the guiding lights of his character and the main attraction for his followers. Also important to note are his urbanity of character, sincerity of purpose and untiring devotion to his duties. All these and many other precious traits of his character attracted people's admiration towards him. But to me he was more loved than admired and revered by the millions of Muslims. Love for the Qaid often bordered on adoration, although he scrupulously avoided appealing to people's passion. This is the one paradox which is rarely explained. The Qaid Azam, as I saw him, had an immensely compassionate heart beneath hard crust of his austere and proud personality. It is his compassion for the distressed Muslims that plunged him into politics. It is his burning desire to alleviate their miseries that threw him into the battle against the mighty forces opposing Pakistan. And it is his profound faith in the principles of Islamic social justice which helped him shape his sovereign polity. The Qaid Azam is no more, but he has left behind for us to follow his noble precepts and principles. His principles stand for a happy society in a polity based on the tenets of Islam. This is an unending and indeed ever-enchanting and enhancing exercise. Hence the supreme need of following the ideals of the Qaid today as ever before. In other words, although the man in the Qaid has died, the friend, philosopher and guide in him remains alive. And it will remain alive forever. It is immortal, it is eternal, it is celestial.